I literally hear my wife questioning me what piece of junk I have brought home now. And she's right, at first glance at least, this really looks like garbage.
The question is, can I bring this dusty piece of technology back to life and build a multi-format disc copying machine from it?
Retrocomputing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories.
As you can see here, it's not in the best of all conditions, and from a preliminary test done earlier, it barely turns on. I hear the fan spinning up, and also the initial beep can be observed, though the screen stays dark. I would start by removing some of the add-in cards and also the drives and cabling, stowing it out of the way in order to get a better access to the innards. But even with most removed, just keeping the bare minimum of the mainboard and graphics card connected, I wouldn't get any further signs of life. I disconnect the power supply from the mainboard, and these plugs easily give it away that this machine is a 90s pre-ATX standard period machine, as the power supply still features the classic 80s style plugs. Luckily enough, I brought a second mainboard of the same period with me, which I'm temporarily hooking up here. The CPU fan is noisy as hell, but even here I wouldn't get any signs of life. Even when swapping out the graphics card against the one that came with this machine, still nothing. Well, not thinking too fatalistic about one or even two broken mainboards, but it can simply be as well faulty RAM or maybe the graphics card. Alright, I hear the series of error beeps. That's much better than before, as it's complaining about the missing graphics card, something it clearly didn't do before. Well, all good things are three. I took another graphics card from my stock, and see here, finally I get something on screen. A 166MHz Pentium with a generous 64MB of RAM, that's not too bad. And here's something I observed when installing the graphics card. The capacitors on the mainboard elevate almost as high up as the lower boundary of the graphics board. There's only a few millimeters of distance in between. Eventually, I removed the original mainboard from the chassis. Not because it's broken. Actually, another test run with a different graphics card revealed this one working as well, so I could as well leave it in. But as you can see here, it has this Odin RTC chip, which has the CMOS battery contained inside, whereas the other mainboard features a coin cell holder. And I totally don't want to deal with the RTC chip at the time. So I pulled the mainboard, also for the intention to remove the CPU. As you can see here, it features this massive passive cooler, whereas I have this noisy fan on the other mainboard. As I saw from a previous test that both are in fact 166MHz CPUs, I'm just going to swap them over and go with the passive cooler. And while everything is out from the case, I give it some cleaning. There's some stickers like here on the original specs of the machine. But I'm sure this is not a machine of any historic significance, but an everyday machine of the 90s. Now, don't ask me what this goo is, but it goes away quite well, and the bezel actually looks quite decent once cleaned. Unfortunately, I didn't pay attention to this broken off part on the top of the bezel. It doesn't look too worse, though I need to figure out how to best fix this. Back to the mainboard, where I was swapping in a new coin cell, and after mounting the replacement mainboard back into the chassis, I'm pulling some of the memory modules. I have some higher capacity ones left over, so I may be able to bump it up a bit. Nice, now I have 96MB of RAM. As I'll be going with Windows 98 2nd edition, that's plenty. So, what goes inside this machine now? It must be networked, so I'll put this RTL-based network adapter in place. And this Adaptec 2940 SCSI adapter. Plus this PCI USB 2.0 host adapter. For the boot drive, I'm installing a CF2ID adapter board, one that plugs into the backside expansion slot so that the CF card is accessible from the outside. Plus 8 ton of cables. The BIOS of this mainboard, which is actually the ASUS TXP-4, is modern enough to feature disk auto-detection, and it has no issues detecting my 8GB compact flash card. As this is going to be a disk copying machine, this includes capability for burning CDs, so I'm installing a CD rewriter as well. This is also important, as I need it next to also bootstrap the Windows 98 setup from a bootable CD. One may think having a CF card will speed up the installation routine, but that's not actually the case. While it definitely adds some schwuppdizität when working on Windows, giving you almost an SSD-like experience, the Windows setup won't benefit from it for large parts and still take almost an hour to complete. And as with every newly installed system, you still need to install the drivers for the occasionally unrecognized add-in cards, like here for the network adapter. And remember this, the good old Logitech mouseware. Or the usual suspects for add-on software needed, plus the obligatory defragmentation run. Something that's almost forgotten these days. So for building a disk copy station, of course I need a variety of floppy drives. But simply installing a 3.5-inch and a 5 1/4-inch floppy drive is not good enough. Would I go for high-density drives? Or for low-density drives? And then there's a limit of 2 drives per machine. It's true that the original IBM PC 5150 supported up to 4 drives, but PCs have lost this capability over time, as with the advent of hard drives this became less and less a requirement. Now, I was investigating how I could do it. And I remembered that once I had an Adaptec SCSI adapter, which had separate connectors for standard floppy drives. Maybe that's an option, to combine the two controllers, one being the primary controller of the mainboard and the other being the one on the SCSI controller. And then, during my investigation, I came along the video of TechTangents.
Oh, you're doing the copycat once again.
Hold it, you haven't seen my video yet. And TechTangents' video is just about great and I can only recommend to watch this, as it has lots of background information and gave my project an entirely new direction. And this is actually the Quad-Flop 4-port ISA floppy controller, which is available at TexElec. TexElec is a household name in the community, as they also provide things like the XT2CF adapters and many others. And for less than $60, what could go possibly wrong? The adapter plugs in any 16 or 8-bit ISA slot and allows to connect up to 4 floppy drives, from the regular 3.5-inch ones up to the 8-inch drives. The controller is intended to fully replace the standard 2-port floppy controller on the mainboard, so it must be disabled in the BIOS. Once installed, the Quad-Flop controller will pop up this prompt from which the drive characteristics can be configured. In this example, I configured a 1.4MB 3.5-inch drive and a 1.2MB 5 1/4-inch drive. The card comes with a built-in diagnostics display, which gives details on the drive activity, for example on which track the drive currently operates. The display can also be detached from the card and relayed to a front-side panel. The flatband cable and some additional headers, which you need to solder to the board in this case, come complete with the package. But I'll just leave it as is for the time. Now, for the floppy drives, it wasn't too hard to get some working 3.5-inch drives geared up. But when it came to the 5 1/4-inch drives, I really took a beating. I had 5 drives available for both double density and high density variations, but out of the many, ultimately only one worked, which I then finally installed. I need to give a deeper look at what's wrong with the other drives, especially the double density drives, as I really want one of these as well. What's important to mention is the drive lettering. The first 2 floppy drives will receive the letters A and B as usual. Any subsequent drives will occupy the first 2 drive letters following your hard drives. So you see here that I in the meantime had installed a second hard drive, this time over a real one to complement my primary compact flash boot drive. Also, I have currently 3 floppy drives configured, out of which drive 0 and 1 will receive the drive letters A and B, and drive 2 will receive the first one available after any disk partition, which in my case is the drive letter F. Back to crafting, I need to still care for that broken off piece of plastic on the front bezel. I'll just use some foam plastic to fabricate the minimalistic mold that I'm temporarily affixating to the bezel using some paper tape. I'll then use a fiber plastics compound to fill up the missing part from the inside. Once dried, I remove the mold. The insert doesn't look too nice yet. It needs some polishing and I need to cut some excess materials in a straight line. And eventually, with everything fixed up, mounted and the cables neatly stowed away, the case can be finally closed again. But I'm not fully done yet. Here I have 2 Iomega drives, the SCSI-based JAZ drive and a ZIP drive that hooks to the parallel port. Nothing easier than that, installing the Iomega there and that's it. But of course not. The setup assistant would only ever recognize just the JAZ drive, which was also visible in Device Manager and Windows Explorer, but not the ZIP drive. I went through several iterations, even going via save mode to uninstall and reinstall the iomegaware over and over again. This was especially odd, as I just had run the same setup on another machine where it worked right away.
Maybe your parallel port is broken or misconfigured.
So I thought as well, but when trying via the DOS client guess.exe, the ZIP drive is properly recognized. Well, eventually, when going through all these hurdles, I noticed one difference between this machine and the other one where the ZIP drive worked, namely the absence of the Iomega parallel port SCSI adapter. Maybe the presence of the Adaptex SCSI adapter messed up something with the iomegaware installer. Ultimately, I went into the hardware wizard and added said parallel port SCSI adapter manually. And guess what? Then after, the ZIP drive miraculously appeared in the iomegaware post-install wizard. Last but not least, I hooked up this Magneto-Optical SCSI drive as well. And with that being done now, my disk copy station finally supports almost every removable media technology that I need.
Apart from 8-inch media, and less to say, 5¼-inch, 360KB double density floppy drives, which I'm still in the search of a replacement.
Or either fixing the ones you have already.
Or either fixing the ones I have already. Also, I'm still looking around for an actual SCSI ZIP drive, or preferably even 2 of them, as these are more reliable on the SCSI bus than through this parallel port pseudo SCSI weirdness. But after all, mission accomplished. I have a disk copy station now, which should greatly facilitate my endeavor for recreating legacy floppy disks. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching and see you again soon. If you check out this channel's community tab, you'll find some polls on potential upcoming videos. You're very welcome to upvote on upcoming topics or drop in new ones you'd like me to chase down.